Let's make welcome Apostle Michael Oropo.
Somebody give the Lord a big hand. Hallelujah. These sound people, they have a plan. This morning again is my honor to be here. I want to again very lavishly celebrate our mama. I was discussing with Venerable when we were going, seeing the magnitude of what going on here. I said, this thing is God's presence. It takes God's presence to run something like this. From the infrastructure, to the excellence, to the passion, to the dedication, to the magnitude of people. Women in their thousands, married women, young women, it's not intelligent talk. This is the presence of God. Even if you succeed gathering people like this, getting people to be passionately dedicated when you are not watching, His Spirit is whispering to them. Can we celebrate the labor and the sacrifice? If your ministry commands the presence of God, you will know what it takes. The presence of God is not just the anointing. It's not just power. It's the weight of His glory. It takes order. It takes sacrifice. It takes brokenness. It takes hours upon hours in the place of prayer. It's not a joke. Can we celebrate our mother? And can we celebrate all the mighty women that have stood with her for all these years? Over 30 years. That is dedication. That is loyalty. We honor you as a person and as a system and as a move of God. And we will take it as a burden to keep praying for what God is doing here. This is hope for a generation. And you have done it for almost 40 years. That means a generation is about to be complete and a new generation is about to emerge. And so I know our coming at this time is not a mistake. We hold a stake in the next generation. And so we will labor in the place of prayer to ensure that what God is doing is transferred and the next generation will understand it. Because it's easy for young girls to come see what God is doing and they enjoy the flamboyance, the excellence, the influence, and they will not pay the price. They need to understand that your knee has been on the altar for decades. And until they understand that price and are willing to pay that price, they don't qualify for the inheritance. And so we trust God that He will grant that level of understanding. Thank you so much, Mama. We love you, we celebrate you, we honor you, and we pray that God will keep you. In the name of Jesus. It will be unfair not to appreciate the welfare people. My goodness. My goodness. I think everything here is at another level. I was talking to my wife and I told her I should have come here 4 days ago. I've been blessed. And I want to appreciate everyone for laboring with all their hearts. From the welfare, to the media, to the protocol. So much honor, so much love. You could feel it. We thank God for everyone. And I know God will bless generously in Jesus' name. Once again, can we celebrate God's servant, Venerable Ike Egbonu. Thank you so much, sir. He's hosting Reverend Dr. Omar Pai today. I wasn't expecting to see him because it takes a government to host a man of that magnitude. But love has necessitated his coming, and it's always an encouragement to have you. Thank you, sir. Hallelujah. Are we ready to receive? Lift your hands toward heaven and talk to the Father.
Kadosh, is the Lamb of God who sits upon the throne. He alone is worthy of our praise.
Bless your name. We honor you. Thank you for your graciousness. Thank you for your mercies. Thank you for your love. Thank you for your kindness. Thank you, Lord, for uplifting us, for strengthening us, for keeping us. And Father, thank you for giving us the understanding to participate and partner with your Spirit, even in advancing your purpose on the face of the earth. We bless you for the lives that will be touched even this morning. And we ask that what you will do this morning will abide forever. In Jesus' precious name. Hallelujah. You may be seated. God bless you. You know, sometimes you just want to keep worshiping. God is so awesome. God is so awesome. This morning, I will try as much as possible to compress the things I want to share because of our time. Maybe in the last 5 minutes, if I don't lose track of time and I still have much time, in the last 5 minutes or 10 minutes, we'll trust God for his stirring and the release of grace and virtue. We began last night talking about making a difference and what that essentially means. And I advanced 3 perspectives to that subject. I said, number one, to make a difference implies bringing intervention to the lives of people. And I said, in order to bring intervention to the lives of people, you must have power, because it takes empowerment to create a change. It's not something you wish or desire alone. It's something that must be backed with power. Even Jesus, the Son of God, with his robust credentials, could not bring intervention to people's lives until he was empowered. He was there for 30 years. He was called co-equal with God. He was called creator. He was called life. He was called light. But the people in Zebulun remained in darkness until the Bible said in Luke 4:14, he returned in the power of the Spirit. The moment that happened, he said, the land of Zebulun, the land of Naphtali, by the way of the sea beyond Jordan, Galilee of the Gentile, he said, the people that sat in darkness have seen a great light. Many persons want to make a difference in the lives of others, but unfortunately, they don't have the empowerment to do so. It's a requisite credential. And I said, this power can be supernatural or spiritual power. It can be economic power. It can be governmental power, but by all means, there must be power if you will bring intervention in people's lives. And if you are not bringing intervention to people's lives, it means your life counts for so little or for nothing, regardless of what you have. You may have cars, you may have money, you may have whatever. It is the degree to which you impact people that gives value and essence to your existence. But that will take empowerment. Number two, I said, in order to make a difference, your life must contribute in transforming others. And I said, there's a difference between meeting the material needs of people from transforming their essence or their being. You can give a poor man a job, give him money. You have really not helped him except as you begin to change his value systems. Because it's poor value that made him poor in the first place. His problem is not money. Giving him money, giving him food is necessary intervention. But building values of discipline, integrity, focus, dedication are the things that will really impact his world. And so I said, beyond provoking intervention through power, we must also advance value systems that transform people. And so the Bible said in Acts chapter 1, verse 1, that of all that Jesus both began to do and to teach. So it was a value system he communicated. The reason most times our world and people around us are not transformed is because we are not what we want to tell them. You find a father who is a drunk telling his son, make sure you don't drink. The DNA has transferred another information. So no matter how loud you shout it, it will. So we must pay the price to build the right value and also communicate those values. And so the second way to make a difference is to engender transformation. And then I said number three, in order to create a difference, you must have structures, programs, and systems that make for sustainability. If there are no programs, if there are no structures, if there are no systems, even if what you do is worthwhile, its scope will be very limited and its lifespan will be very short. I'm seeing flags of nations here, and I know people came from those nations. It takes a lot of programs. It takes a lot of structure. It takes a lot of systems to be able to run what we are doing here and replicate it in different nations. When God was speaking to Adam and empowering him, he said, God bless them. Genesis 1, 28. And he said, be fruitful, multiply, replenish, subdue, have dominion. It's a sequence, a systematic program that not only increases the scope of what is being done, but preserving it. I was talking with some sisters a moment ago while we were having an interview, and they told me there are different clusters of what is happening here in the United Kingdom. That's a lot of organization. That's a lot of wisdom. That's a lot of structure and programs. That is why this auditorium is filled today. That is why people are affected in different nations today, because there's a program. There's a structure around finance. There's a structure around prayer. There's a structure around leadership. There's a structure around sermonizing. If these things are not there, there'll be randomness and chaos. And that randomness will destroy everything we've labored to achieve. And so making a difference, therefore, is a product of power, is a product of values, and is a product of wisdom. Wisdom that materializes into programs, structures, and systems. If you don't have these three things in place, your life can never make a difference, regardless of what you have. Are we together? And so last night, we began advancing the subject from the angle of power. And I decided to use the anointing. And the first point I made was that every one of us who believes in Jesus is anointed. And I said the anointing, as defined in Acts chapter 10 verse 38, is the Holy Ghost and his life force. You see how God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Ghost and power. Power is one of the life force of the Holy Spirit. But it's not limited to power. There's wisdom there. There's favor there. Everything that flows from God is part of his life force. And so when a man is anointed, he's anointed with a person and the things that flow from that person. That person is the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit dwells on your inside and the life force rests upon you. The Holy Ghost that is on your inside is what transforms you. He said you have an unction from the Holy Spirit in 1 John chapter 2, verse 27. And he said that anointing teaches you all things. So the Holy Ghost on your inside is there to transform you and to make you become like the God that you worship. And so the emphasis of the anointing within is transformation and relationship, to know God and to become like God. Whereas the emphasis of the anointing upon is to do the works of God, is to enable you to do the works of God. That's why power rests on you, but the Holy Ghost is inside you. But this allocation is only for those that believe. Acts 2:38, he gives them the Holy Ghost to them that believe. Everyone who believes is anointed with the Holy Ghost and with power. And so, therefore, none of us is excused from making a difference, because the requisite power for making a difference is already in our possession. If you are here and you believe, the Holy Ghost is already there. In fact, Jesus speaking in John chapter 7, verse 38 and 39, he said, they that believe, out of their bellies shall flow rivers of living waters. And in order to also help us understand the scope of the impact and the difference we can make, I took up time to outline 5 things the anointing does. And the first thing I mentioned was the fact that the anointing brings relevance. The moment Jesus was anointed, Luke 4:14, Luke 4:18, Matthew 5:15, he went into the synagogue and began to work wonders. And the Bible said his fame went abroad. So Jesus immediately became the center of attraction, the influence that created change in that society. And so every man who is anointed is a candidate for relevance. And this is why, like Mama was saying a moment ago, it is an error to look down on yourself. Because even if you had any natural advantage, that advantage is not an advantage when spirits are involved. If a spirit is involved, eloquence is not an advantage. If a spirit is involved, beauty is not an advantage. If a spirit is involved, money is not an advantage. You can have money and die. You can have beauty and be stranded. You can have eloquence and nobody wants to hear you. What makes whatever advantage you think is an advantage is when God breathes upon it. If God breathes upon your words, kings will hear you. If God breathes upon your beauty, princes will look for you. If God breathes upon your money, it will create systems that will outlive you. So it is the breath of God that brings relevance, not material things. And so the first thing I said gives us relevance is the presence of God and the anointing of the Spirit on our lives. Number two, I said the anointing empowers us. I'm not putting it in the order I outlined it yesterday now, but just to give us a recap. The anointing empowers us for mighty works. Jesus, although the Son of God, was like an ordinary person until he was anointed. For 30 years, no record of a blind eye opening. For 30 years, no record of any healing. For 30 years, no record of any prophecy. For 30 years, no record of any supernatural thing happening. But the moment the anointing descended, immediately things began to happen. The people looked at him in Mark 6:2 and they said, what kind of wisdom is given to this man that he does these mighty works? The Bible revealed to us that the reason he was able to do those works was because he was anointed with the Holy Ghost and power. And so everybody who is anointed can do great things. Why am I explaining this? It helps you to look away from your limitation. Because the reason many people are not making impact is because they have judged themselves and they have assumed they have nothing, they are good for nothing, they have nothing to offer. You don't need to have anything to offer. If God comes upon you, God is enough. You tell somebody, go and head this fellowship. He say, what will I tell them? He say, when you get there, don't bother what to say. Open your mouth, I will fill it with words. You tell somebody to go and represent, they always look at themselves from the negative light. Because of the things they've been through, your circumstances don't have the power over you except you allow it. The moment you become anointed, mighty works can issue out of you. The least of us here can take this world, because it's not by power, it's not by might, it's by the Spirit of the living God. Number three, I said the anointing sanctifies. And I said sanctify or sanctification in this context is not purity. It is to be set apart for God. Because of this, God defends the anointed, because the anointed has become his property. In Psalm 105 verse 15, the Bible said there was a law issued in the Spirit. He said he rebuked kings for their sakes. And he said, touch not my anointed, do my prophets no harm. Anybody who is anointed is God's property. This is what imparts boldness to us. Because we know you can't do nothing to us because God is our defense. You're threatening me, I don't pray about it. Because of the understanding I have about the anointing. If you don't have that understanding, it's good to pray. But because of what I know, and because of what I know, I got it. And because of who I know is with me, I'm not bothered. I hear people, several people issue threats, say evil. I don't even have time for that. I'm too busy trying to take my word to bother myself with what somebody said. This person said this against you. This person said that. The Lord has sanctified me. where I am needed, where I'll be honored, where I'll be celebrated, where I'll be blessed, God takes me there. So if you like, say what you want to say. Have you not seen that they paint somebody black? The moment they are done doing that, that's when the king asks for the person. So the corridors where they are painting you black, you don't need to be there. Because the people who have time to do such things, you don't even need them in the first place. So no matter what they do, it doesn't matter where you are needed, where you will be blessed, where you will be honored. God will make sure that your integrity is kept there. God will make sure that you are beautified there. Because those who need you and those who can empower you and bless you, they will keep needing you because of the sanctification. That's what the anointing does. That's why you shouldn't be bothered. Don't have high blood pressure because somebody gossiped you. Both the person gossiping and to whom is you are gossip, they don't matter. And they can increase, but you will. They can increase, but you will not be stopped in what you are doing. Everybody who matters, you will see that that gossip will not affect them. Somebody can go somewhere to gossip you. As the person they are gossiping you hears, he will now be reminded that he wants to bless you. So, the gossip is actually a reminder. He would not have remembered you before. So, this person thought he was going to speak evil of you. The man will now go and sleep and say, but wait, I'm supposed to give that person 10 million. Now that I remember, let me do it quickly. They go somewhere and they try to destroy your image. And somebody say, who is this person they are talking about? He now hears you. The next day, there's a conference in Oklahoma. He say, can I invite that person? I love what I heard. They went somewhere and say, wanted to discredit your business. Somebody now heard and say, are they doing this kind of business in Onisha? So let me get some supplies. So they give you unsolicited publicity. It's because of the anointing. You know why? They are saying something, hoping to create an impression. While they are talking, the Holy Ghost is creating a different impression in the heart of the one hearing. If you know this, nothing will trouble you. They speak good of you, glory to God. They speak evil of you, glory to God. They don't speak of you, glory to God. You will find rest. You will find peace. And you have a good, fruitful old age and rest with the Lord. You see people trying to explain themselves, defend themselves. In a multitude of wars, there's iniquity. Relax. Don't bother. Somebody is speaking on your behalf. There's an unction on your life defending you. Relax. He said the light shines in the darkness. Light does not shine in light. It's in the darkness. They should create darkness so that you can shine brighter. The anointing sanctifies. Number four, the anointing breaks yokes. Isaiah 10:27, it said, the yoke shall be broken and the burden lifted off your shoulders because of the anointing. Number six, the anointing brings wisdom and divine direction. And so spiritual accuracy, in addition to study, in addition to training and discipleship, is also a product of the leading of the Holy Spirit, the anointing at work. He said, if you are going in the wrong direction, you will hear a voice behind you telling you, this is not the way to go, turn back. Not because you are experienced. Experience is a good advantage. But even where your experience fails, there's an anointing that will insist that you are accurate. Have you not been there? You want to invest in that business and you lose your peace. The anointing is talking. And then you say, wait for 4 days. And that 4 days you are waiting, you sense not to do it again. After 3 weeks, the business crashes. Your 100 million would have crashed, but the anointing stopped you. There was no fact, information on ground that suggested why you shouldn't. In fact, the business is so lucrative, you would have gained 200% increase. But the anointing said, no, that's not the way to go. You cannot rationalize it mentally, but your spirit has already rationalized it by the anointing. And so you stop. And many people are divinely preserved because of that leading that comes by the anointing. And number six, I said the anointing imparts speed. And I said the reason that is so is simply because Many programs of God in your life have seasons. If you lose your season, you will double your effort. You will do much more. It will still not have the impact it would have had if you did it in your season. And so in order for you to remain in your season so that relevance can be attained, the anointing will insist that God does the quick work and he cuts it short in righteousness. He said the hand of God was upon Elijah, and Elijah outran the chariot of Ahab, even unto Jezreel. There is a speed that comes because of the anointing. Having seen these benefits of the anointing, it is lack of wisdom for a man not to understand the anointing or deploy it. It now reveals to you that every physical thing you have is good, but the anointing is better. And so because of that, even while you work hard, you will grow in the anointing. While you gain experience, you will grow in the anointing. While you school, you will grow in the anointing. I've schooled, but I'm also growing in the anointing. And I can tell you one thing the anointing has done for me. My 3 degrees put together can't do it. It's a strange phenomenon, but it's the power of God at work. Are we together? And so you must learn to grow in the anointing, especially now that you know that the anointing is already there. What then do you do to stir the anointing? Number one, you know, yesterday it was a bit intense, so you may enjoy the words because they are inspired. But it's also good to understand this sequentially. That's why I'm doing this brief recap. I said, number one, to stir the anointing, you must have a consciousness that the anointing is there. You must have the consciousness that you are anointed. Jesus came, Luke 4:18. He said, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me. He didn't say it's on earth. It's upon me, for he has anointed me. In case you do hear the first one, he has anointed me. That is double emphasis. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, for he has anointed me. And he didn't just anoint him. He knew exactly what the anointing was meant for. That is consciousness. That is consciousness. If you don't have the consciousness of the anointing will not work. Some of you here have an anointing for world creation, but you are not conscious of it. Some of you here have anointings for leadership. When people are confused, asking questions, you just look at them and you are wondering, why are they confused? Do this, it's done. What is the big deal here? It's an anointing, it's not intelligence. It's an anointing. Some of you have an anointing for excellence. Some of you have an anointing, you know, for reaching out to people. People are struggling. How do we meet this person? You say, call this person, you'll meet this person. I had a friend. Anybody you want to talk to in this world, he will say, give me some minutes. It's not very powerful, but he knows who to call somebody to call that person that you are looking for. He's like a bridge. He's a connector. He can meet anybody. He can link anybody together. He's just a grace. You may be 10 times more influential than him, but you can't do it. There are those who have unction for organization. They can enter a hall that is empty. They say, put the stage there, put white here, put blue here, put purple, put pink. You are wondering, how will these colors match? Wait until he finishes. When it's done and you see the blend, you will know that the Spirit whispered to him. And that person who has an unction for organization is going to struggle with the person who is leading song in choir. He now carries the microphone, and when he's singing, people are saying, which song is that? He's sleeping. People start sleeping. Your grace is not there. The reason we compete is because we are not in our area of specialization. You have no reason to envy the other person. He is operating based on the grace on his life. Allow him, encourage him, pray for him, find your own. With the anointing, you can be an usher and have more impact in the system. With the anointing. And without the anointing, you can be the president and flop the whole system. Don't struggle. See, what we carry is divine. It can make anybody shine anywhere. David said, even in the presence of my enemy, my cup runs over. So prosperity is not even where you are secured alone. Even when you are not secured, you can prosper. And your enemies will not remember to kill you. They desperately want to kill you, but they won't remember to. Because the anointing is mystical. It's mystical. You have grace for prayer. Because somebody preached and people clapped. You want to preach. You now carry the microphone. You stutter from beginning to end. Even the people who loved you before will start hitting you. The next time they see you in front, they start saying, hope is not going to the microphone. Hope, hope. If only you were praying, you would have changed the system from your altar. And even if men don't know, God knows. Angels know, and they will celebrate you. You find people who should be dogged intercessors. When the man starts praying, even the house vibrates. When he's praying, he can be there for 12 hours. He doesn't even know time is going. And as he's praying, he's seeing visions. Everything he sees happens. But he wants to come and carry mic and start prophesying. This week, everything he says will not happen. And he won't relax and stay in his place. Function in the area of your anointing and have honor and rest. Build that consciousness and you will not be intimidated. You will not be under pressure. You will not do what you are not supposed to do. You will just function where God wants you to be. And at the end of life, you will be fulfilled. And then you will realize the greatest asset of the soul after salvation is fulfillment. If you don't have fulfillment, you can be a billionaire. Your life will be hell. If you don't have fulfillment, you can be a superstar. Your life will be hell. If you want to have fulfillment, you have to discern the anointing on your life and walk where that anointing leads you, because the anointing will move you. Number two, I said to stir the anointing, you must learn to speak to yourself. In Ephesians 5:18, it says, speaking to yourself in psalms, in hymns, in spiritual song, making melody to the Lord. See, this is why you cannot allow wrong information get to your soul. See, when people are gossiping people, greet them and go. You don't need to carry those words. When you are going through challenges, don't allow the challenge tell you what to do. He said, why men are cast down? You say. He didn't say you are lifted, though. He said, you say there's a lifting up. That means it's your saying that will lift you up. Because when you start saying, the anointing goes to work. If you don't say, the anointing won't go. The reason men are cast down and they are buried is because they are talking the cast down. Did you see how God functioned? He said in Genesis chapter 1 verse 1, the earth was in chaos. Darkness was upon the deep. God never mentioned darkness. If not because Moses wrote the story, you won't know there's darkness. God was saying what he wanted to say. Light be. You see somebody saying, this headache will kill me. Oh, this fever will kill me. It will kill you. It will kill you because the anointing will either not work or it will work depending on what you say. If you say it will kill you, go ahead and die. You will be anointed and die. Didn't you hear that the bone of a dead man rose another dead man? A man died, was decayed. His bone had enough anointing. The question is, how did he die? Somebody who died and is rotting, another dead man touched his bone, there was enough anointing to raise the dead man. And that's the problem with many people. When you meet them, you say you have problem, they will counsel you, you will come out of it. You say you are sick, they will make declaration, you'll be healed. But in their own case, they will not do what they do for others. This is why many preachers die. They preach people out of their problems, but they preach themselves into their own doom. Because when they come to the altar or when they are talking to people, they act as ministers. Somebody tells you his marriage is crashing, his business is crashing. You say, be of good cheer. The Lord is with you. Whatever happens, you will come out of it. He will talk that person and encourage him out of that problem. But in his own case, he quarrels with his husband. The next thing, he turns the house upside down. And starts saying, because you say this house, things will not work, it will not work. If you will tell yourself what you tell people, your life will change. Tell people the right things and tell yourself the wrong things. That's why the anointing in your life is working for people and not for you. Be not drunk with wine when in its excess. Be filled with the Spirit. Number three, to stir the anointing, you must grow in the revelation of Jesus Christ. Jesus is the anointed one. And everything you know about Jesus increases the measure of the anointing in your life. He said, grow in grace. 2 Peter 3:18. And in the knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. When you grow in the knowledge of Jesus, the unction on your life also grows. Grow in grace and in the knowledge. You must strive to know Jesus more every day of your life. The more you know Jesus, the more the unction grows. Number four, how do you stir the anointing? By prayer. And I'll talk about prayer here. In Matthew 17, verse 2 and 3, after 8 days, he took Peter, James, and John, went to a solitary place. There he prayed. And as he prayed, the fashion of his countenance was altered. His raiment began to glister. If you read that same scripture down to verse 18, 17, 18, and 19, they brought somebody who was deaf and dumb. The disciples couldn't cast out the demon. Jesus came and said, come out of him. Instantly, the spirit threw him down, but came out. And the people said, what mighty power is this? At first, he returned in the power of the spirit. Now, he's operating mighty power. Because every time he prayed, he stirred the anointing. He stirred the anointing. When you pray, you may not feel anything. When you pray, you may even appear tired, but in the spirit, you glow. It's impossible for you to pray and the glory of God on your life does not increase. Prayer causes you to glow in the spirit. And so men who understand how the anointing works, they don't need a prayer point necessarily to pray. Prayer is part of their lives. Because as they are praying, they are stirring the oil of God on their life. Number five, how do you stir the anointing? Through worship. When you worship God, he adds more to you. When you worship him, he adds more to you. The problem with Christians is they don't know how to live the Christian life. Christianity is very simple, but it must be practiced. You don't worship because they gave you a car. You don't thank God because something good happened. You thank God as a lifestyle. In Jeremiah 30 verse 19, the Bible said, out of them shall proceed the voice of thanksgiving. And he said, I will multiply them. They shall not be few. I will glorify them. That's the point I'm making. When you begin to thank, worship, and praise, God begins to glorify you. And he said, you shall not be small. So there is something about praising God that stirs the anointing. In Acts 13 verse 2, he said, as they prayed and ministered to the Lord, the Holy Ghost began to move. And the Holy Ghost said, separate unto me, Paul and Barnabas. Every time we minister to the Lord, we praise, we thank, the anointing is stirred. The anointing begins to work. But the problem is, many don't make it a lifestyle. Finally, how do you stir the anointing? To live in unity. To express love towards one another. The Bible said in Psalm 133, verse 1 to 3, behold, how beautiful and pleasant it is for brethren to dwell together in harmony. He said, it is like the oil upon the head of Aaron that flows down his beard, even unto his skirt. He said, it's like the dew upon Mount Hermon. There, the Lord commands his blessings. If you know these things, even if somebody offends you, forgive him before he asks for it. Because you are not forgiving him necessarily because he's reasonable. You are forgiving him because your peace is tied to it. Jesus said, if you go to the altar with an offering and your brother has an ought against you, he didn't say you have an ought against him. He said, leave that gift there. Go and make peace. I'm telling you why Christians are supposed to be the most powerful people on earth, yet they appear helpless. One person is keeping malice with 30 people. And people take pride in the fact that they don't forgive. They will tell you, me, I won't forgive him. You? Mama said something yesterday that struck me like an arrow. He said, you who is insisting you want to be left alone, you want to be left alone. He said, one day you will be left alone. Don't let that day come. Leave me alone. Who is he to talk to me? Who is he? You, who are you? If they remove God from you, you are dust. You are the one building that false impression about yourself. If God is taken from you, you are dust. We can't live together. One of the signs of mature Christianity is the ability to live in love and unity. It takes forbearance, it takes patience, it takes kindness to be able to live in unity. And that's why when God finds a man who can live in unity, or a people who can live in unity, he releases the anointing like a river. He said, in that place, there's a corporate ranking. The same thing Aaron is feeling. That's what the person who is at the level of the garment is feeling. There's an equilibration in the operation of the anointing. You can no longer tell the difference between the head and the skirt. It looks as if there is too much for everybody to live supernaturally. It's not every anointing you stare by, wah, wah, wah. No. Your husband is the one who is wrong. You say sorry. Sometimes when you say sorry, he becomes egoistic. I thought you said you are a strong woman. You say sorry. I would have dealt with you. Sorry. After a while, he will not look at himself. Am I a demon? Even if he doesn't tell you, when he goes to say hello, the Holy Ghost will come back. You know, you can intimidate men, not the Holy Spirit. The Holy Ghost will come back and say, how come they said sorry 3 times, you were not moved? You can't shout on the Holy Spirit. You can't act around the Holy Ghost. He is God. And he will keep telling you that even when he's sleeping, he will be hearing that sorry. That sorry. That sorry will become an echo. He will hear sorry. He will hear sorry because he will hear it until he will lose his sleep. Did you not read what the Bible said? He said, those who are married even to unbelievers, he said, their modest lives will convert them. That means your character can be equivalent to the word of God. And this kind of character is effused in forgiveness. That's why God doesn't joke with it. You want to see people who are dangerously anointed, they have protocols they obey. They have protocol. You are the one who see these people as powerful. They are actually broken men. They can tell you how many places they knelt down where they were not supposed to kneel down. You don't forgive people because they are reasonable. You forgive people because you were forgiven. Because if it's about being reasonable, none of us was reasonable. They say, all we like sheep have gone astray. There was no one among us that was reasonable. If it was about qualifying for it, for those of us who keep insisting that you must qualify, if it's about, if God gives you what you qualify for, you will vanish from this earth. If God gives you what you qualify for, is death, shame, and judgment. Because all of us were guilty. And the penalty for sin is death. He said the wages of sin is death. The only thing we all qualified for was death. But the Bible said, while we were yet sinners, he said, Christ died for us. So you don't forgive people because they deserve it. You don't forgive people because they are reasonable. You don't forgive people because what they did is small or big. You forgive them because you were forgiven. And that's why those who understand forgiveness, they don't wait for you to ask. They forgive you even when you have not asked. They forgive you in advance. When you ask, they thank God because you are growing. This is the secret of power. That's why great power rests on great humility. Great power rests on great brokenness. Great power rests on great humility. Because the school humility will carry you through. The school. You will die many times. You will die. But it's in that death that life comes. That's why I say God kill it and he make it alive. That place where you went to humble yourself, that's where God will exhort you. You will now discover it's not by power, it's not by might, it's by the spirit of the living God. You lose nothing by being humble. And every time we fight for unity, we are strengthened. The greatest power in the world today is in the corporate expression of the body of Christ. He said, wherever two or three are gathered together in my name, He said, there I am in the midst of them. That's the anointing. And he said, whatever they bind on earth is bound in heaven. Whatever they lose on earth, that's power even in the heavenlies. So you want to stir the anointing in your life? Forgive people in advance before they ask. And see how dangerously anointed you become. You want to stir the anointing in your life? Sustain humility. And see how, because these are the forces that makes unity possible. They say God, he exalts the humble, but he resists the proud. So your enemy will not be man, it will be God himself. He resists the proud, but he giveth more grace to the humble. You want to be dangerously anointed? Learn patience. Learn long suffering. And see the way the anointing will start flowing out of your life like a river. Many times, even before you pray, God will be doing mighty things. And you'll be asking yourself, what fasting did I fast to provoke this anointing? There are realms beyond fasting. Because even criminals fast. Rogues fast. Wicked men fast. But it will take God for a man to sustain forgiveness, brokenness, patience. It's called the fruits of the Spirit. Stirring the anointing. Stirring the anointing. It's through humility. He said, when brethren dwell together in harmony, the oil flows from the head to the beard to the skirt. He said, it's like the dew upon Mount Hermon. He has entered the glory realm. And he said, there the Lord commands his blessing. Your home can become heaven if you fight for unity. There's no enemy in the home front. You and your husband are one. What you fight for in the home is unity. It's love, it's oneness, not who is right from who is wrong. If one person is wrong, everybody's wrong. That's the problem we don't realize. So you strive for unity. You strive. And then something beyond you will go to work. You will now be amazed how your husband can be broken. That one that thinks is iron, he has not collided with an immortal. Everybody who met God fell like a dead man. Everyone who met him, they fell. He will lose his strength. He will now discover that there are powers that build the foundations of the earth. The anointing. Built and stirred through unity. I'll stop here. Let me talk briefly about the things I want to talk about this morning. I'm already entering it. So to make impact, you need power. Number two, to make impact, you need values, character, and virtue. There are many values we can begin to talk about, but this morning I want to talk about two. Two that I feel is holistic. Number one is love, and number two is excellence. You know, when Mama was teaching about love and I came in, I was so blessed because I had it in mind to share. Love is one of, there are few words in scripture, if you study biblical theology, that are really very massive words. And one of those words is love. Another is sacrifice. Some of these words, they separate them to study them individually in biblical theology because of the scope. And because Mama has done a very great job on love, I won't dwell there so much, but I just want to make a few points. And I want us to write them down and go back and study, because I won't have time to deal with them. Two scriptures, very quickly. Galatians 5:22. You study them so you understand love. He said, but the fruit. He didn't say the fruits. So he's talking about one thing. He said, but the fruit of the Spirit is love. So the fruit of the Spirit is one, is love. But love has 8 other tributaries in this scripture. He now began to expatiate love. He said, joy. Now, joy is not happiness. Happiness comes from things. Joy is from the Spirit. That's why joy imparts strength. He said, the joy of the Lord is your strength. There are many people that say, my joy has been taken from me. Why? He lost his car. Or somebody quarreled with him. No, your happiness can fluctuate. And you are human. It can. But in the midst of the challenge, there must be a river flowing from your spirit that nothing, no one can take. Nobody should have the authority, and nothing should have the authority to be able to take your joy. Because your security is in your joy. But you can't know joy until you know love. And let me explain to you, the person who quarreled you or insulted you, if you have love, you will not be angry with the person. You have compassion. Because the person did what he did because he doesn't know better. Why do you think Jesus was praying for those who were killing him while he was on the cross in excruciating pain? He had the right to be offended at them, but when he looked at them, they didn't understand that this whole project is salvation. So he was praying for them to understand it quickly so that they can benefit from him. Imagine you are praying for people to benefit from killing you. Because he came to save the whole world. His killers inclusive. So he said, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. How can a man be killing you? He has love. The love is too deep. So most of the people you quarrel with, you should pity them. You should pray for them. Because that position they have taken, they took that position because they lack understanding. If they had understanding, they would do better. I heard a story of a woman, I think from somewhere around Rwanda or something, during the genocide. I've forgotten the exact place. And some young men broke into her house. Killed her family. They killed the husband, raped the daughters, and slaughtered everybody. Even the woman was slaughtered. But somehow the blade, the knife didn't cut her windpipe. So she was there helpless. Until help came, she was resuscitated, treated, and she came back. Can you imagine the level of anger and vengeance she should feel for the killers? In fact, she was so mutilated that some of her features were damaged. One day, she found one of the killers lifeless. And they were about to destroy them. But they discovered the guy was still breathing. The woman took the killer and treated him. And adopted him. And the boy became his son. And the boy didn't know he was the one who killed the family. Until after many years, the woman now told the young man the story. That you and your friends came to this family. This is what you did. At this time, the woman had found joy. She had found peace. So, she turned a criminal to a missionary. It's the boy's testimony that some of us read. That the woman whose family he destroyed is the one who made him. That's the same program God ran when Jesus died for us. The ones who killed the son were the ones they adopted. I'm standing here now and say I'm an apostle. Me, a thief, a criminal, everything evil is what man is. Because if you break one, you broke all. I am part of those who killed Jesus. We were guilty. God now decided to empower us and put his spirit on us. What kind of love is that? That's why I say the love of God surpasses knowledge. You can't explain it. This is why you find peace in love. There's so much peace. When people offend you, you read it from a different perspective. Your colleague is trying to pull you down and you are looking at him. What are we fighting for? You know very well that the value of a man's life is not in the multitude of his possession. He is fighting for this position and wanting to kill somebody because he doesn't know that. So instead of being aggravated, you will have sympathy. And you will now pray for God to remove the scale from his eyes. And so when Paul was defining love, he said, love is what? Peace. He said, love is joy. Love is long-suffering. Why will you be patient with somebody who is against you? Because you know the day understanding comes, he won't be taking that position. And he didn't just say long-suffering. Meanwhile, it's important for you to know that long-suffering, it means to suffer for a long time. It's to suffer for what? A long time. But he calls it the fruit of the Spirit. Every character is built from love. Everyone. There's no character that can exist outside love. Everything we call character is a different flavor of that realm called love. Long suffering. Write these words down. Go and study them when you have the time. Gentleness. Gentleness. The reason you are not, even the people you help them with respect. It's a goodness. Goodness. It's not that you are giving somebody money. Hey, come over here. That one is not love. You don't want to be disturbed. So you use the money to pursue the person. Gentleness. Goodness. Goodness. The reason your child will rub the same cream with the house girl in your house is goodness. Because you know that one too is somebody's daughter. And you know that this person who is under you is not the one who is privileged. You are the one who is privileged to be a mother to an extra person. Because it's a blessing to be a parent. And if you think it's not, go and ask the woman looking for child. If you think that the little girl in your house who is washing plate is the one you are helping, you are wrong. You are the one who is privileged to be called a mother by another person. You come to certain houses, the room of the master's children, the food they eat in excess and throw away is better than what the house guests eat. And he comes to church, he say, I'm an intercessor. Shabba shabba, kaba kaba. You are a hypocrite. You don't know what prayer is. They lie on the altar. They are rolling from one side to the other. God will be looking at you. What are you doing? Go and read Isaiah 58, verse 6 to 8. He said the people are fasting and God is asking them, what fasting are you doing? He said fasting is goodness, is kindness. So if there's no love, there's no fasting. What are you doing? You are killing your organs, putting yourself through hunger, and you call it fast. This is not fasting. You are not being good to people. What are you calling fasting? Your child is using one soap, but somebody else's child should use Lux, or should use bar soap. Soap that you can't use to wash clothes again. That's what the house girl is using. When you turn to your child, hello, darling, how are you doing? You turn to another person's child, get out from here. You don't know love. They say love is goodness. Goodness is not about the person you are dealing with. It's about the quality of your spirit. It's not about the people. It's about who you are. That's why God is kind to the sinner as much as he's kind to the righteous man. When Jesus met sinners, he dined with them. Because it's not about the people, it's about who he is. So if you can be good to one and bad to the other, it means you are not good. He said, love is goodness. And he said, love is faith. The reason you can believe in God is because you have enough love for people to believe in you. If people can come to you boldly and ask you for things, and even the last one you have, you can give, you will know that the God who is not exhaustible will not withhold anything from you. So when you approach God with confidence. Because even you who is human, people approach you and they receive answers. Is it God that we approach and not have answer? Those who are hungry come to you. The little you have, you share with them. So you are assured that even if what God has is one, he is able to give you. Because he said, God is better than us. That's why I say love is faith. The people you don't know, you bless them. Is it you that God knows that he won't bless? So you are now persuaded that you are not just going to be blessed, you are already blessed. Because you have shown much more to people. And if you can show that much to people, then God has no reason to withhold anything from you. That's why love is also faith. And in Galatians 5:6, it says, faith worketh by love. The reason many can't believe God is because themselves are too wicked. So they use themselves to interpret who God is. Because people beg you, you can't give them. You think you too, you have to beg God so much before God gives you. Somebody needs food, he goes and pray naked 12 midnight. Because before you give him food, you must be in shame. Before he gives you food, rather. So he thinks that's how hard God is. God is not that difficult. You are using your difficulty to interpret God. Stop interpreting God from who you are. You can't believe God except you have love. And this is just a preamble. This is not the major context. It's in 1 Corinthians 13 that Paul now redefined love. And I won't explain that. Let's just read it. I don't have time to explain. I'm trying to show you what character, virtue, and values are. Everything rests on love. And that's why in verse 13, it calls it the great. He said, though I speak with tongues of men and of angels, I have not love. He said, I have become a sounding brass. Forget the many tongues. The prayer is useless without love. Ibakubako, ekukukua, akakaka. He said, it's a simba. It's the way you hit this drum, gong, gong, gong. That's what you are doing in the spirit. It's noise. If God wants to help you, he will tell you to shut up. Please go further. He said, though I have the gift of prophecy and understand all mysteries and all knowledge, not some, all. He said, if I have, and though I have all faith, imagine, all mysteries, all knowledge, all faith. Faith that can remove a mountain. He said, if I have not love, that is nothing. So removing a mountain means nothing if there's no love. You know, we don't know, there are things that matter. We are going to take Afghanistan. We are going to take Pakistan. But the little gear in your house doesn't have food to eat. Which Afghanistan do you want to take? Start with the Afghanistan in your house. There's a huge Afghanistan in your backyard. Go, 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 please. We don't have time. Though I bestow all my goods to feed the poor, because this is where politics come in. Stand up with camera. We are giving to orphanage. In front of the camera, you hold the children and smile. Where camera goes. It's hypocrisy. Hypocrisy. What you are looking for is the approval of men, so that men will call you a philanthropist, a good man, and they'll give you a title. You have your reward. God is not moved by action, no. It's the motive that moves him. Go on, please. Some people are even so selfish that they can allow themselves to be killed so that they can leave an impression in the heart of people. Have you not seen people like that? Somebody wants to deal with his husband. He now writes a letter and hangs herself. Or a man hangs himself and writes a letter that my wife is the reason for this. Wickedness can make people to die. There's no love in it. Somebody can die on a course just for the impression should be to be left that he's a good person. Meanwhile, he has no connection with the people, but he wants to be a hero. People are that selfish and that proud. They say, even if your body is given to be burnt, if there's no love, it profits you nothing. In order for you to understand what he was talking about, he now decided to define love with many registers. Let's see. He said, love suffers long. Do you know what it means to suffer long? Jesus said, if your brother offends you 70 times, 7 times in one day, forgive him. Now, that's 490 times in one day. Imagine if you have 7 brothers. Now, in this auditorium, we have over 6,000 sisters. If one offends you 70 times, 7 times in one day. Now, what will happen if you live with that person for 10 days? Somebody who offends you 490 times in one day. If you live with him for 10 days, that's 4,900 times. If they are two, that's 10,400 times for two of them. Now, imagine if you live for 1 year and for 5 years. That is what suffer long means. It's a love suffers long. It's a love does not envy. Everybody can prosper. And I don't have to prosper before others prosper. Everybody. It's a love does not parade itself. It's not about you. It's about Jesus. The service is not powerful because I'm the one who sang. Somebody else can sing and I'll still be blessed. I mustn't be the one who is the center of attraction. There are many people, because they are no longer involved, they won't participate. If they are the one to address the media, then they will give their all for the campaign. If they are the ones to preach in the crusade, they will give their all. If they are not the one, if you like, 10,000 people should come to that crusade. Even if their church is at the backyard, they won't come. In fact, they can even go and tell their members, don't give money there. Because it's not in their name. Love does not parade itself. Learn to celebrate others from the depth of your heart. Learn it. It's love. Go further. He said it's not proud. It does not behave rudely. You need to find somebody who is intelligent among illiterates. You need to find somebody who is wealthy amongst the poor. The way he will look alone, everybody will be shaking. He will now say, he is a powerful man. No, you are a tyrant. You oppress people with your advantage. No. When you have an advantage, that advantage is meant to empower others, not to oppress them. In your light, let others see light. That's what love insists on. There's no glory if you are the only one shining. Because you are shining, let many more shine. And when, hear this, and when they are shining, they don't have to give the glory to you. Because there are those who either trample you or they will make you shine so that you can glorify them. The day you stop glorifying them, they will kill you. So the reason they helped you is not because they are helping you. They are using you to build further validation to them. And if you are no longer validating them, you can never rise. You must die. Take this money, go and pay your school fees, but make sure you do a video and let people know I'm the one who gave you the money. You are not interested in his school. You are just using his poverty to enrich yourself among men. Please go further. They say it does not seek its own. It is not easily provoked. It does not think evil. Please, you need to write this thing. See, go and read this scripture. Take your time. Pick it one by one. If you allow these things to dominate your life, there can be no realm where you'll be indicted. That's why I said, against love, there's no law. Don't be easily provoked. Don't think evil of others. He said, that is love. That's what he was talking about in verse 1 to 3. Put the scripture. It does not think evil. Go further. He said, it does not rejoice in iniquity. You need to see believers when a sister falls. Hey, we said it. Is it the fall of somebody else you are celebrating like this? They become evangelists. A sister who has not preached to 5 people about Jesus will tell 30 people about somebody else who they heard something. Something that is not even verified yet. Hey, did you hear what Sister Martha did? This world is finished. Oh, they love those things. They rejoice in people's failures. Some are even so wicked that they are waiting for you to fail. They are hoping, praying and prophesying for you to fail.
And when you fail, they'll say, yes, we said it. Come on, what were you expecting?
When a brother or a sister fails, you should weep as though you are the one who fails, because our corporate rank is depleted. And these are the things God looks at. That's why God exhorts people. You will come and look at them and think it's because they are talking in a certain way or they know something. If you don't have this thing, he said, men look on the outward. I, the Lord, I search the heart. You can be a better businessman, God will empower the other person. You can be a better preacher, God will empower the other person. You will sit down and say, what is this person preaching? It's not what he's preaching, it's who is exhorting him because of his heart. Let's round up. I want to talk about prayer. It rejoices in truth. It bears all things. It bears. Whatever you say, love can bear. It believes all things. It hopes all things. It endures all things. It has that capacity. Some people's heart is so shallow. So shallow. They are so small in their heart that even when you are blessing somebody else, they are offended. How can you give that person 10,000? The reason they are saying it is not because they are interested in your savings. They are hoping that the money would have come to them. So they are now pained that you gave the money to somebody else. How can you do this kind of thing? If you give them, no problem, but don't give another person. You are stingy. You want everybody around you to be stingy because you hate the prosperity of others. And when God sees these kinds of things, if you like, pray on the mountain for 4 years. When you finish praying, if God wants to help you, he will give you food. Go and eat and rest so that you don't die of ulcer. Nothing will happen. Because if God empowers you, your empowerment will become the fall of many. If now that you don't have influence, you are frustrating 10 people. What will now happen if you have influence over 10,000 people? The only influence you have is over your house gear, and your house gear is looking for how to escape. Is it a state God will give you influence over? You have influence over one vulnerable gear, one. And that one gear that you have influence over is dying. If she has the opportunity, she will escape. If people are coming to visit the house, you give her new clothes. And everything she's doing, she's looking at your eyes with fear. You are hugging her for the first time. Let people see that. Why are you behaving like this? Why would she behave like that? It's what you were doing for the past 10 years. That's what is influencing. You want... I'm telling you why. Hear this. I'm telling you why we may be prayerful, we may fast, we may belong to a successful organization, yet we can't make a difference. Because if God sees that you have influence over one vulnerable gear, and that gear cannot give a good testimony about you, he will never give you influence over his system. He will never give you influence over his state. He will never give you influence over a nation. Because you have proven that you are wicked. And so what God would rather do is what to do to save the small vulnerable girl from your wicked cover. You think God will allow 10,000 people to come under that same frustration that girl is going through? No, he won't do that. That's why many gifted people, many prayerful people never make a difference. They don't have love. Every character is born out of love. Whatever you call it is born out of love. And the key to activating love in the hearts of men is the gospel of Jesus Christ. He said, the love of Christ constrains us, for we thus judge that if one died for all, they that live should no longer live for themselves, but for him that died for them. When you realize what Jesus did when he died for you, you will let go of everything. You will now start living for Jesus. And if you start living for Jesus, you will be patient, you will be forgiving, you will be kind. Let me read the scripture as I leave this topic. Philippians chapter 2 from verse 5. If I have the message version, that would be great. Philippians 2, verse 5 to 9. It said, think of yourselves the way Jesus Christ thought of himself. See how he thought of himself. He said he had equal status with God. It's the gospel that will make you think like this. Because he's trying to show you what Jesus did in order to save you. And so he's expecting you that going forward, you should do it for others. He said he had equal status with God, but didn't think so much of himself that he had to cling to the advantages of that status no matter what. Jesus is co-equal with God, but he didn't pride himself in it. Seated here, some of us may be senators, wives of senators. Some of us may be heads of massive conglomerates, owners of businesses. But he said, when you are relating with men, don't hold on too much to that advantage. Everybody must not relate with you as senator. There should be a place where love makes us to become sisters. That's why it's called sisters fellowship. You know, some are senators, some are governors, some are business owners, but when we come together because of love, let's become sisters. So he said Jesus did not cling to his advantage as God. So much so that Jesus can call you and I his brethren. Where? What parameter is considered? In what realm can I be called the brother of Jesus? There is no realm except in the realm of love. It's only because of love that Jesus can call me his brother. I am clay, he's God. I'm mortar, he's immortal. He formed me from the dust. How can I become his brother? I'm a creation of his hand. But because of love, the Bible said he did not hold on to his status as God. Number two, he said he did not hold on to the advantages he had as God. Do you know the advantages? Forever and ever he's worshipped. He doesn't know lack. He doesn't think anything that doesn't happen. He operates in a realm that anything he calls become. If Jesus looks at you and he said, bread is there. If he thinks of anything he says becomes. That's the level of authority. But he left all of those advantages. And he said something. Leave the scripture, please. That scripture is more. Don't show me. Keep this thing there. Let's be seeing it. This one creates transformation. He said, when the time came, he set aside the privileges of deity. If he could put aside the privilege of deity, who are you to hit your hand on your chest and say, do you know me? Who are you? I'm the wife of so-and-so. What and so what? I'm this and this and so what? Are you God? The one who is God put aside the privilege of deity. They slapped him. He turned the other side. When Peter wanted to react, he said, relax, sir. If I say one word, 12 legions of angels will appear here. One word. Meanwhile, one angel can kill 185,000 soldiers in one night. If 12 legions comes, the whole world will be swept. He had all those privileges. When they were beating him, he still had the right to say, all of you die. When they approach him, he said, whom seek ye? They said, Jesus of Nazareth. He said, I am he. They went back and fell. They stood up again. They thought it was air that threw them down. Whom seek ye? They said, Jesus of Nazareth. He said, I told you already, I am he. They went back and fell. He now looked at them and put his hand. They now handcuffed him and started slapping him. Somebody that say, I am he, you fell. If he said, die, you die. And you are slapping him because he put aside the privilege of deity. Not our generation. You'll find people claiming they are humble. They are walking everywhere. Make a mistake and address them wrongly. The way they will turn and look at you. The first thing they'll tell you is, don't make the mistake because I choose to humble myself. How dare you talk to me? Madam, you are not humble. That thing you are doing is an act. My goodness. Is it because I came here? Is it because I'm ushering? Is it because I'm serving? How dare you talk to me? They will, every hair on their body will stand. They will be shaking like this. He said, Jesus set aside the privileges, the advantages of deity. Ah! He didn't stop there. He took the status of a slave. The reason you fall is because you are standing. When you lie down, you can't fall. You have built a mountain for yourself. Why do you care what they say? If you don't care, they can say whatever they want. Have you seen a slave before who is angry that somebody insulted him? Have you seen a slave before who is offended that somebody disrespected him? Slaves don't consider themselves to have rights. So anything you do, they accept it. And the little you give them, they are grateful. He said he took the status of a slave. He became human. And see what he said in the next verse. He said, having become human, he stayed human. He said, it was an incredibly humbling process for Creator to become creation. If he chose to be slave in the Godhead, it would have been okay. At least he's still God. It's just like you now going into the pig kingdom and becoming a pig. It was an incredibly humbling process. I'm showing you why we don't have character. We have not known what love is. And so we are under pressure to create impression. We are easily offended. If you put aside all the privileges you think make you what you say you are, and take the status of a slave, who can offend you? Do slaves get offended? But it's not because he's a slave. He's only responding to the promptings of love. He said he didn't claim any special privileges. Instead, he lived a selfless, obedient life. And he didn't just live that life. He died living it. He died living it. And he said it was the worst kind of death he died. In obedience. This is why Paul speaking, he said, the love of Christ constrains us. When you want to be angry, love will constrain you. Looking for is the approval of men. So that men will call you a philanthropist, a good man, and they'll give you a title. The wife of so and so, what and so what? I'm this and this, and so what? Are you God? The one who is God put aside the privilege of deity. They slapped him, he turned the other side. When Peter wanted to react, he said, relax, sir. If I say one word, 12 legions of angels will appear here. One word. Meanwhile, one angel can kill 185,000 soldiers in one night. If 12 legions comes, the whole world will be swept. He had all those privileges. When they were beating him, he still had the right to say, all of you die. When they approach him, they say, he said, whom seek ye? They said, Jesus of Nazareth. He said, I am he. They went back and fell. They stood up again. They thought it was air that threw them down. Whom seek ye? They said, Jesus of, he said, I told you already, I am he. They went back and fell. He now looked at them and put his hand. They now handcuffed him and started slapping him. Somebody that say, I am he, you fell. If he said die, you die. And you are slapping him because he put aside the privilege of deity. Not our generation. You'll find people claiming they are humble. They are walking everywhere. Make a mistake and address them wrongly. The way they will turn and look at you. The first thing they'll tell you is, don't make the mistake because I choose to humble myself. How dare you talk to me? Madam, you are not humble. That thing you are doing is an act. My goodness. Is it because I came here? Is it because I'm ushering? Is it because I'm serving? How dare you talk to me? They will, every hair on their body will stand. They will be shaking like this. He said, Jesus set aside the privileges, the advantages of deity. Ah! He didn't stop there. He took the status of a slave. The reason you fall is because you are standing. When you lie down, you can't fall. You have built a mountain for yourself. Why do you care what they say? If you don't care, they can say whatever they want. Have you seen a slave before who is angry that somebody insulted him? Have you seen a slave before who is offended that somebody disrespected him? Slaves don't consider themselves to have rights. So anything you do, they accept it. And the little you give them, they are grateful. He said he took the status of a slave. He became human. And see what he said in the next verse. He said, having become human, he stayed human. He said, it was an incredibly humbling process for Creator to become creation. If he chose to be slave in the Godhead, it would have been okay. At least he's still God. It's just like you now going into the pig kingdom and becoming a pig. It was an incredibly humbling process. I'm showing you why we don't have character. We have not known what love is. And so we are under pressure to create impression. We are easily offended. If you put aside all the privileges you think make you what you say you are, and take the status of a slave, who can offend you? Do slaves get offended? But it's not because he's a slave. He's only responding to the promptings of love. He said he didn't claim any special privileges. Instead, he lived a selfless, obedient life. And he didn't just live that life. He died living it. He died living it. And he said it was the worst kind of death he died. In obedience. This is why Paul speaking, he said, the love of Christ constrains us. When you want to be angry, love will constrain you. When you want to lie against somebody, love will constrain you. When you want to envy somebody, love will constrain you. When you want to be arrogant, love will constrain you. And so when you begin to operate by love, the best of characters begin to flow out of you naturally. It is that character of love that transforms men. Nobody cares what you want to give. It is the spirit with which you give it that they want to know. If you like, give the best gift to a man and don't do it in love and respect. That gift will lose value. The value of the gift is not in the gift. It is in how the gift was given. There's a woman in scripture called Dorcas, Acts chapter 9, from verse 36 to 40. The Bible used her as an example of love. She didn't preach one sermon, not one. There was no record that she preached. There was no record that she even called herself any title. She only showed love through generosity. When this woman died, the Bible said they sent an envoy to call Peter and to plead with him to come and raise her back to life. The only testimony the people had was that this woman was generously kind. They showed the garments that she gave them. So when she died, people rose up in her defense. The people would have rather died in her stead. We need to understand this thing called love and begin to live it. Our world will become better. If Christians begin to live by love, the impact will be stronger than they are preaching. Because many callous men are preaching, many wicked men are preaching, many evil men are preaching, many criminals are preaching, and many wicked people are preaching. They are talking about a God they don't know. And so when we preach, the energy that leaves us is different from the message. Meanwhile, the souls of men don't only interact with the world, he also interacts with the energy. I can't talk about prayer. I'm out of time. Let's bow our heads. The most beautiful among thousands, my beloved is the most beautiful among thousands, Yeshua. Hear this. There are two things I'm doing now as I leave. Number one, there's a way you should live your life. Whatever you want to do, do it as unto the Lord, and your life will change. Anything you want to do, do it as if you are doing it to Jesus. Your life will change. And you will start impacting people immediately. When you want to talk to somebody, talk to that person as if you are talking to Jesus. When you want to give to somebody, give to that person as if you are giving to Jesus. When you want to react to a circumstance, react as though you are reacting to Jesus. And see how you start impacting your world. People will start seeing God in you. Many times, we are the ones standing in the way of what God wants to do because of our wrong character. This morning, I want to call for prayers. Somebody wants to rededicate herself to the Lord. I've called myself a Christian. I've even preached the gospel. But my life doesn't reveal it. And you want to ask God to help you this morning. If you are in that category, please stand up. Let me pray with you. Not everybody now. Those who want to rededicate themselves. I imagine that this stage may not be able to accommodate us.
Put you in front of me. If you were all that matters, if you were all that matters, for two, you and I, Jesus, you were all. You are all that matters.
Hear this. Anybody can be transformed. Just show them Jesus. And don't show it through your message alone, but through your character. Anybody can be transformed. The reason we are making this call this morning is not just so that God can intervene in your life, it's so that you can also go to your world and change it. Please help mama. Please help mama. Please help mama. I didn't even talk about excellence. What a body. The Bible said something. It said, even those who are married to unbelievers, he said their modesty, their meekness, their humility can change them. The same way the word of God will change them. So if we truly want to be change agents, we must show the life and the character of Jesus to our world. This morning, I want to invite God's servant, the Venerable, just to pray over us.
they are gone.
When next I have the opportunity, maybe I'll talk about excellence and prayer. You know, excellence is not just how you appear. How you appear is the byproduct of excellence. Excellence is actually a spirit that insists that you do what must be done. That's excellence. That's why I wanted to talk about it. The reason these colors are the way they are is because the spirit of excellence insists that light must be at the angle. If it means setting it 50 times to get that angle, you will pay the price to keep setting 50 times until you get the angle. So it's not the ambience, it's the spirit that insists that it must be done rightly. The reason you are dressed well, I can give my suit to somebody and he will appear clean. It doesn't mean he's excellent. Excellence is you insisting that the tailor sews it according to your shape and that you will not wear it until it's ironed. And so whatever it takes for you to iron it, you iron it. The reason you preach a message and it makes sense is because excellence insists that every verse you must read, you will read it. And so sometimes you have to sit down for 5 hours reading so that you have enough raw material. So that doggedness, that devotion, that dedication, that focus, that loyalty to dot every I and cross every T, that's the spirit of excellence. And our generation don't have excellence anymore. Everybody wants to jump into what is working, but they don't pay the price to make it work. Excellence is the price for things to appear good. You want to be excellent, you must be disciplined, you must be dedicated, you must be diligent, you must be faithful, you must be patient, you must be careful. If it's one dot missing, you must put that dot. Even if it will take you another 7 hours, you will pay the price. An excellent man can be awake all night just to get one line correctly. And so when he's talking, you will appreciate the appearance, but it took labor. These two things is what makes for character. Before an excellent man talk, he's careful, every word, careful. And sometimes it will take 5 years to have that training. He will listen to what he said and repeat it again until he gets it right.